if you look at three interesting forces that are going on in the financial and the career arena, one is that a huge number of people are quitting their jobs and they are wanting to become entrepreneurs, which is admirable. And by the way, just as a parenthetical little piece of fun factoid, I was involved with Icy Hot before it was sold in retail stores. I was involved in Entrepreneur Magazine when it first came out. Nobody knew the word entrepreneur. Nobody knew when we came out what entrepreneur even meant. We had to send all of our subscription offers and our membership offers with, on the outside of the envelope, Webster's Dictionary's definition and also pronunciation, because no one even could pronounce the word. So I go back a long time, and I just lost my brilliant thought. Okay, so here's the three distinctions. You got all these people quitting their jobs and starting a business. Now I'm going to give you the however. However, statistically, and you're the angel investor, one out of 24 makes it. Okay, so if you got a 5% probability, and if you make it in year one, 10% make it 5 years. So why would you want to put yourself at a 95% failure rate and a 90% failure sustaining rate when you can get control of a business that's broken through but is underperforming, and then you can blow it up with my stuff, and then you can flip it in 2 years for more than you would normally make in 40, and then you can take the proceeds and do it again and again at a higher level? That's one premise of the book. The second premise is, if you're a business owner and you're trying to grow conventionally, even with my stuff, you can go a lot more if you get control of not just related competitive businesses, but complementary, I mean, competitive in two forms. Competitive meaning the same product or service. Complementary means things people buy before, during, and after. And then there's another role of competitive. If people don't buy your category of business, but they're going to buy something else, if you compete with yourself, it's very enlightened. For example, if we were selling a supplement for weight loss, we could say, let's buy another supplement company that sells supplements for weight loss. We can overlay them, duplicate them. But we could also say, well, most people who try to do weight loss don't stop at one thing. They'll buy portion control food. They'll buy exercise equipment. They'll buy a private or a group trainer. They'll buy books. They'll buy recipes. They'll buy all kinds of things. Why don't we compete against ourselves? Because they only use ours for a finite number. And when they stop, we've got the sunk cost in the investment in the asset, which is the relationship. And we have the sunk cost in the knowledge of the media. But most people don't think that way. They say, I'm going to sell a supplement. So you could acquire that and blow it up. The last is, if you're a passive investor and you're getting whatever, well, right now, if you freeze frame it, you're not getting much, but hopefully you are getting, what are you going to get? What did they get last year before the market blew up? 28%. Yeah, if you can get 28%, but if you could put somebody passively to do what I'm talking about for you, and every 2 years you get 2,000%, that's sort of interesting, isn't it? Yeah, so that's the book. The other book, which I find more interesting, I'm doing with Anthony Scaramucci. You know him? And those of you who don't know him, he's a character, but he runs a big hedge fund in New York, and it's a fund of funds, and he's also been in the political arena a bit, and he's a very colorful and provocative person. But we're doing a book together that's called The Alpha Life. And the concept is that anybody that understands investment, hedge fund's goal is twofold. And we talk about this all the time, the other Nick, it's to get an asymmetric upside and minimize and de-risk the downside. And a good hedge fund has a portfolio, and they could have many portfolios. Anthony has a fund of fund, which is even more interesting. They invest in funds, and some of the funds have portfolios. But the idea is, you've got a portfolio, and that portfolio has different risk assignments and different yield, and when it alters, you adjust your allocation, right? Pretty simple. But if you look at a life, our life is like a hedge fund, but you're a human hedge fund or a business hedge fund, and you're allocating pretty significant assets in terms of opportunity cost, emotion, expectation, health, relationships, But I advocate that you don't have a clue what the percentage you're allocating is. You don't have a clue what the risk associated. You don't have a clue what you're getting. You don't know what mean is. And how can you know what alpha is, and you don't have a reference of what alpha is supposed to look like, and you never adjust your portfolio? And that's the premise of that book, which I think is pretty interesting. You like that?
Yeah,
I think it's going to be good. And we're using hedge fund terms, but we're translating them to life or career. But anyhow, I'm telling you that not really to be impressed with me, but for you to think about implications of a life. My whole career has been predicated on where's the upside leverage in what you're doing, and how many ways can you expand, extend, and mitigate the downside in that leverage? How much more can you get now? How much more residual can you get out of the same effort? How much more can you do with it? How much can you repurpose it? How much can you reactivate and remonetize sunk costs? I'll give you an example. I have a client, and I took him from 20 million to 140 million in 1 year with one cool concept. It doesn't matter what the concept is. But what matters is they spent $50 million over the last few years on lead generating. And they've got a business that has a $10,000 service. And they have 400,000 unsold leads, which was 90% of the leads they get they don't sell. They still make a lot on the ones they sell. But if you look at a portfolio, that means they have 90% of $50 million sitting in assets that aren't earning a penny. If you were managing a portfolio that had $50 million and wasn't earning a penny and was diminishing every few months, you think your clients would let you keep it? So I yell at him all the time and say, why in the world would you let that asset that was 90% of your investment go just because you made money on the other side? But most people don't think that way. And so you have to start saying, where's the leverage in what I do? And you tie it always to where's the leverage in what I do within the congruency of the value that I need to convey to the market so that I don't, sell out my integrity.